Hi, I'm Karen McKee, a retired scientist and author. As an author of more than 100 peer-reviewed papers, I know something about the challenges involved in getting published. I've been sharing my insights on this YouTube channel for about 2 years now. If you are a researcher or plan to be, an important part of becoming a successful author of academic papers is being familiar with the literature in your field. This means you must read a lot of papers. Obviously, having critical reading skills will help you be more efficient at this task. Critical reading skills also help when you are asked by a journal to review a colleague's manuscript. In this video, I'm going to describe a strategy that will help you efficiently read a paper and extract the essential information you need. The exact approach you use to read papers will depend on your purpose, of course. But let's say you have one paper to read for a class discussion if you are a student, or a paper you want to include in a review article you are writing if you are a researcher. Most scientific papers have a consistent structure with the following sections: abstract, introduction, methods, results, discussion, and conclusions. You want to start by getting an overview of the paper. I usually read the abstract first, as well as any highlights, then skip to the conclusions to get an overall idea of what was found and why the authors think it's important. Next, I scan the figures and tables to see if the data clearly tell a story that agrees with the stated outcome. I might spend a bit of time on this to get my own impression of the evidence before reading the author's interpretation. Then I go back to the introduction and read it with several questions in mind. What's the stated topic of the paper and why is it important? What research has been done so far and what information is needed? Is the literature cited appropriate, relevant, and up to date? What problems, questions, or hypotheses are addressed in the study? After reading, I write out the answers to these questions in my own words. After reading the introduction, I usually want to know how they went about answering their questions. This information is given in the materials and methods. If I'm familiar with the system under study, I may skim the description of the study site or the organism under study. I can always come back to this later if I have a question. I pay close attention to the experimental design and analyses, however. Is the experiment designed well, using appropriate controls, randomization, and replication? Are the analytical methods appropriate and up to date? What precautions were taken to minimize bias or operator error? Were the statistical tests appropriate? After reading the methods, I often take a minute or two to ponder whether I would have done anything differently and make a note of that. At this point, I usually have a good idea if this was an in-depth and rigorous study or not. I next skim the results since I've already scrutinized the figures and tables. Here I'm looking for additional details or data summaries not readily apparent in the figures and tables. But the main thing I want to know is, did the study produce clear answers to the questions or hypotheses addressed? Or were the findings not clear-cut? Now, there's nothing wrong with results that did not provide a complete answer, but recognizing this raises the expectation for a discussion that goes into some detail about why. At this point, I'm ready to tackle the discussion. How does the author interpret the main finding? Does the author describe alternative explanations for the outcome? How does the main finding compare with previous research in general terms, that is, agree or disagree? What are the main strengths and/or limitations of the study, and how do they affect the interpretation? These are all questions that the author should answer in the discussion. If they don't, then that tells you something about the quality of the work or the writing. Finally, I reread the conclusions and answer the following questions. In general, does the paper report something really new, or is it a confirmation of prior work? What are the broader implications of the findings? do the results have relevance to other types of systems? Do the findings have any practical applications? What additional research needs to be done in the future? After you read through the paper once, you may want to go back and reread some sections or parts of sections to confirm a specific point. I should emphasize that this approach to reading a paper is not set in stone. It's what works for me. You may find it easier to read the paper closely from start to finish and then go back and ask the questions I listed for each section. However you choose to read, the idea is to be efficient and discerning. Let's briefly look at another example of reading a set of papers in preparation for writing a paper for a class or for publication. You will want to identify potentially relevant papers by conducting a literature search using keywords. Some papers will be more important than others, and a few may turn out not to be relevant at all. At this stage, you can use the title and the abstract to quickly select those for further reading. Here is the Web of Science database, and I've added a couple of search terms, mangroves and sea level rise. I'm going to restrict the search by requiring the terms in the paper title. As you can see, there are 76 papers found. They are ordered by number of times cited, which will identify papers considered by other researchers to be important. But we can see more recent papers that you might want to read by selecting date or another filter such as relevance. Perhaps we are writing a paper on accretionary processes controlling mangrove response to rising sea level. We can narrow the list down by refining the results. I add the term accretion, and this yields 22 papers. Now we have a more manageable list. We can then scan the abstracts of each one to decide which paper to read in detail. This one, for example, looks at rates of accretion necessary for mangrove survival and looks like one to download and read in more depth. Note that you can see how many times the search term appears in the abstract. If it's not there, the topic likely was not a main focus of the paper and may have just been mentioned briefly somewhere in the paper. This paper, for example, lacks the accretion search term in the abstract and is not likely to be what I'm looking for. You would go through the rest of the list and scan their abstracts, selecting those to possibly cite in your paper. You may find additional papers that you need to read by looking at the citations listed in each paper. Click the title of the paper and then the number of cited papers in the bibliography, and the list appears. To facilitate later citing the papers you download and read, you want to export the citation to EndNote or some other bibliographic application. Then you go through those selected papers and read them as I described earlier. To summarize, developing efficient and critical reading skills is part of becoming a successful researcher and author. I hope this video has provided a few ideas for developing a reading strategy that works for you. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to like my video if you found it helpful.